Welcome to Now is the Time for Quiet Men, a video series that showcases introverted male leaders and focuses on why quiet men today are in the right place at the right time. I'm Ed Fraunheim, one of the co-hosts of this series, along with my partner, Jennifer Conweiler. Jennifer and I are authors and consultants who have combined our interests in masculinity and introversion to shine a spotlight on the challenges, strengths, and strategies of quiet men leaders. We both feel strongly that introverted men have been ignored, overlooked, and even undervalued, sometimes even shamed by type A leaders. But we think now is the time for quiet men. They are uniquely suited for the emerging world and workplace. Their superpowers of calmness, connection, and careful listening are increasingly needed in a more volatile, decentralized, and equity-oriented climate.
So today, we're so honored to have with us Jay Rydd, and Jay is Mountain Operations Manager at Diamond Peak Resort. And Diamond Peak is a ski resort in Nevada right next to Lake Tahoe. Jay oversees all aspects of mountain operations at Diamond Peak, and including lift maintenance and operations, grooming, snowmaking, the ski patrol, safety, property operation, parking, and even the transportation. He is number two in the organization and has at any one time, approximately 100 people, Ed, reporting to him. And he's been there 5 years, and this follows a nice long career in the ski resort and equipment field, including building the kind of half pipes that now we're seeing in the Olympics. So I want to give a warm welcome, or we do, to Jay.
Thanks so much.
Okay. So I want to ask you, our first question is, when did you first realize that you were more on the introverted side of the spectrum?
I wouldn't say that there was ever a realization. Other than my entire life, I knew that I was quieter than other people and more would stand back and be the observer before I would participate in things. And I knew that, yeah, I just didn't necessarily always fit in with the groups that there were as a child.
Okay, so you were observing what was going on a lot, and that was wrong. And how did you ever kind of get that label as you got, as you grew and you became an adult? Did you ever identify with being more introverted?
No, honestly, I never really put a name to it.
Okay, until we reached out to you, right?
Yeah, honestly, you know, I have always known, but I never really put the nail on the head, you know, or hit the nail on the head as to what exactly I would define it as. You know,
sure.
I'm 49 years old, so I'm not of the generation where everything got a label other than you're ADD or you're not.
Interesting. Yeah. So how did knowing that about yourself, that you kind of stood back a bit and watched people, and you weren't always in, you didn't always feel comfortable, I'm assuming, in the group. How did that affect you, knowing that affect you in any particular way?
I just always knew that to be successful, I had to learn to overcome that or work around it, you know, however I needed to. You know, I've never, you know, even like as a kid, I was afraid to, or too intimidated to pick up the phone and order a pizza for my mom or whatever, you know.
Yeah.
So just little things like that, that I knew other people had no issue doing that, you know. Or even to this day, when I'm in a store, I don't like to ever ask for help. And it's not because I'm an ignorant, tough guy, man. It's because I'm just introverted and shy about it.
Jay, is there an example of this issue of being an introverted or quiet man in your work career that you could share?
Well, I mean, again, it's what I've been overcoming my entire career to get to the point I am now. Again, starting off in New Jersey, where there's the most densely populated state in the country, there's a lot of competition every job you have, even if it's just washing dishes at a restaurant in high school. And so I knew I can focus really good when I'm into the task I need to focus on.
Mm-hmm.
So I always would put my head down and work as hard as I could, and learn as much as I could from everyone around me. But again, with that shyness factor of trying to observe and learn versus asking and learning and trying to stay a step ahead and watching and being discouraged by the extroverts getting the attention, and squeaky wheel gets the grease and the squeaky wheel gets the raise and the promotion and stuff.
You referenced this earlier about not like selling yourself or something like that. So you've actually been able to get these promotions and these leadership roles without like, how have you done that from a marketing standpoint? You know, they always talk about self-promotion. How have you dealt with that? Because people, I mean, not everybody knows you. Have you had?
It is that. It's one of those things that I wish I had learned earlier in life. You know, I spent my whole younger years, because of being a shy person or whatever, however you want to term it. I spent my whole life learning how to do everything I possibly could, so I would never need anybody's help for anything.
Wow.
Right. And literally that was my mindset. And I knew someday I'd own a home and I would want to fix things and I didn't want to have to call anybody. Not because I was too afraid to call anybody, but I don't like having to rely on other people. I don't like having other people's help. I don't like needing things from other people. Yeah. I want to be self-sufficient. But I wish that I had been exposed to at a younger age, or taught by somebody, that you get farther by knowing people and working with people and everything. And so a lot of the jobs I've had later in my career are because of people I know. You know, and I've gotten to know through whatever. And like I said, the manager from Vernon Valley back in the day is still one of my great friends. And I'm still somebody who, if I was to apply for a job somewhere, would write a reference letter for me. He's a general manager of a ski area in New York State right now. Most of the jobs I've gotten were through people I've known through the industry in some way, shape, or form, whether they're from seminars and trade shows like I met you at, Ed, or whatever. And to be quite honest, you know, like an example of me overcoming myself is agreeing to do this, right? This is not something I naturally want to do. This is not something I would have said yes to, or even exposed myself to be asked to in the past. I recognize that this would be beneficial, not only to myself, but what I enjoy doing more than anything is, like I said, sharing what I know. So no one has to go through the same crap I've been through.
Yeah.
So if you guys help get this out, what myself and other people might say out to other people, and it helps them overcome themselves sooner, or learn how to navigate the world a little better sooner, that's awesome.
That's really powerful. Yeah, and I think that you probably, just back to that example you said, I'm sure you've helped people, so they know that you're a giving person. You didn't help with strings attached, you know, and even though you didn't ask for help.
Because when we met, or when we got together at that ski industry conference last summer, you made a huge impression on me and everyone else at that session. We were doing, my friend Paul and I were talking about effective teams. And we were talking about the value of check-ins, where you ask about everyone's emotional well-being. And you spoke up at that point, and you said that two men at your resort at Diamond Peak had committed suicide in the previous 18 months or so. And you attributed those deaths, those suicides, partly to the pressure in this industry of men to suppress feelings. And you famously or infamously said, fuck the tough guy show. It stopped the show, and others kind of chimed in with similar feelings, similar sentiments. And I wonder if you can say more about those really tragic events and on this tough guy show that you've identified in the ski resort arena.
Well, I mean, it certainly plays out in probably every industry there is globally, but certainly I know mine best, and it's definitely been a thing. And as far as those two guys were concerned, I don't think it's what caused them to do what they did, but certainly, and I'm not a psychologist or anything, but I've a feeling that most people who take their own life didn't have the opportunity, or didn't feel they had the opportunity to speak up and allow somebody to stop them, you know, and maybe they had, maybe, you know, whatever, but certainly they're two very likable guys, very nice guys, very hard workers. And they were both, each 30 years old and they're both engaged. And
oh my gosh.
You have to think that, and anyone on my crew would have been willing to listen to either one of those two. It's not like they were jerks or they were mean or they were lazy or any of that stuff. They were two very strong contributors to our team, and everybody liked and respected them tremendously. You know, I wasn't super close with the both of them. I knew one better than the other, but I'd worked with them both for quite a while, and they were both very valued members and of our team, and myself or anyone would have taken whatever time necessary to sit down and listen to them about whatever they had to say. And that's what I attribute to the shitty world that we all live in, where you keep it inside and you don't speak up, and that happens. And you know,
so Jay, after that happened, what did you guys talk about what the experience, you know, about how you might you know, set things up so people can feel comfortable talking about their problem?
Yeah, we've had, you know, I've had a lot of discussions with my staff and my coworkers, and you know, certainly immediately thereafter, and several check-ins, you know, soon after. Sure. But it's just I make sure that's what I do all the time, checking in with people and providing.
Yeah.
You know, a forum for them to talk about life, you know, like, let's not talk about work right now. How are you doing? Mm-hmm. You know, and you don't have to share your personal stuff if you don't want to, but if you need a place to vent a little bit, you got some stress going on at home and, you know, you don't want to unload that on your spouse or whatever, like, go ahead, dump it here. Yeah. You know, like,
that's great.
Are you finding that men are opening up more than before, Jay?
Yeah, definitely. It's something I've always worked towards anyway. So it was more my style of leading to begin with. I'm just a lot more conscious of it now than I was before. And so, you know, there's so many days that, you know, I go to work and my boss and I both joke about this, that we go to work and we think about what we're going to do today, and we never do what we think we're going to do. But there's a lot of days I open a spreadsheet or whatever on my computer in my office, and then I never look at it again. And 10 hours later, you know, I've just been walking around talking to the other managers and supervisors and stuff, and some of the frontline staff, and just talking mm-hmm. all day, you know, and that's a big part of what I do. And, you know, is communicate and be the communication bridge between interdepartmentally and interpersonally for everybody, but also to check in with people about their personal lives, because that matters.
So your leadership and the caring that you do, and that's the listening, how do you think that has affected the culture that people might describe your resort as having? Because I'm sure you have a big influence on it, Jay.
Yeah,
I'm in peak.
I've come to accept the, you know, and again, that gets back to my personality. I've come to accept the fact that I'm a good leader. Mm-hmm. It's hard for me to say that out loud. It's, you know, but people seem to like working for me and with me. I try to give them every opportunity to speak their mind and be themselves and not pretend. And that's the key. I, you know, give them what they want, respect their opinions, and, hire the right people, and the team just is successful from there. And everybody, you know, I have a bunch of people who work with me who are very qualified individuals who could all have a job before they got home if they quit their job today. So I like to say the leaders that work with me choose to work at Diamond Peak. Yeah. They could all work somewhere else very quickly, very easily, but they choose to be a part of the team that we have. Yep. Or is it perfect at Diamond Peak? Definitely not. We have a long way to go, just like anywhere does. And there's always going to be expanding room to grow, right? You know, never going to reach the goalpost there. But I like to think that if you've worked somewhere else, you can have a great, much greater appreciation for what we have. You know, if this is the first place you've ever worked, you probably appreciate it pretty good, but you probably think it's like that other places. But a lot of, my coworkers have been at several other resorts, and they understand what we have is a pretty special thing.
Yeah, thank you, Jay. And we also want to thank everyone who has watched or listened to this episode of Now is the Time for Quiet Men. If you liked this conversation and found it valuable, be sure to subscribe to our whole series that showcases introverted male leaders. You can click on the link below to subscribe. So that's it for now. And thanks, everybody, and have a great day, everyone.